Jammu and Kashmir and some other portions of India. It has also tried to synergize terror activities between the Maoists and the Northeast insurgents. The current problem in J&K is primarily Pakistan-sponsored, let there be no doubt on it. Though our problem has been that we have also failed in the last 70 years to emotionally integrate some of our Kashmiri youth into the Indian mainstream. And now, additionally, the terror threats from the Al-Qaeda in the Indian subcontinent and the IS, Islamic State, which is also known as ISIS, that threat is also slowly coming into picture. And the trouble with the IS threat has been that they are attracting educated young men from some portions of the country. Of course, we are all keeping a watch on them. About 25 to 30 people have gone and joined the IS. About 150 boys in various places are also on the scanner of the Intelligence Bureau. Now, before I go further, as part of our overall security preparedness, I wish to highlight two very significant aspects. India has, I'm sorry to say, the dubious distinction of being the world's largest importer of arms and equipment. I wish we were the world's largest exporter, with you young gentlemen sitting here, ladies and gentlemen sitting here, but I am unfortunately we're the largest importer of arms and equipment. But the good news is that in the areas of space and missiles, we are well off and self-reliant. You have all heard of the Prithvi missile, the Agni missile, the Trishul, the Akash, the large missile systems, and apart from the excellent missile system we have developed and fielding is the BrahMos with Russia. Now we are going to export the BrahMos to Vietnam also as part of our strategic design, and the BrahMos missiles will be going to Vietnam. Now some other weapon systems have also been designed and manufactured in India, but not in keeping with our requirements. I'm sorry to say that and admit it. Now yesterday, as you all know, the 10th GSLV, the Geosynchronized Launch Vehicle, launched an all-weather satellite carrying, and this the best thing was that this was the cryogenic engine. So it's a matter of great pride for us that the space people, in which Dr. Kalam, who's been to your university, had played a very, very important part. Now I hope some of you will join the DRDO, that is the Defense Research and Development Organization, and contribute to research in various fields of defense to make India self-reliant. I hope you will join.
Yes, sir.
Also in the nuclear field, you all know we are facing two nuclear armed adversaries. We need to match the Chinese in various aspects of weaponry, mobility and guidance systems, as also in the field of nuclear medicine and importantly nuclear safeguards. Now in the limited time given to me, I will not touch upon the imperatives which are required for India to emerge as the leading player on the global stage. We need, as I said, both security, external and internal, and economic growth. They are both sides of the same coin. That is defense and development. They're not mutually exclusive. They are both sides of the same coin. So what do we need? Must not hold to ransom. critical issues concerning the nation's security, economic growth, foreign relations, and other major policy formulations at the altar of narrow political and partisan motivations. What do I mean is that vote bank politics, which most of these political parties, you know, indulge in, this must be kept to the barest minimum. Thirdly, which I mentioned to you already, that the armed forces must be capable or made capable to successfully confront a 2.5-year war. This must be ensured. Now, another very important point where you all come in, the young fellows, indigenous efforts towards self-reliance in arms, ammunition and equipment must be given further fillip through private and public enterprise, through private and public enterprise and Make in India programs. There's a lot of miles we have to cover to be self-reliant, and I think the future of India and your future of the young men is dependent, not solely, but predominantly when India has its own manufacturing industry, its own manufacturing sectors. We have lots of Make in India, you know, industry, and we are also exporting like the Chinese do or the Americans and the other Western nations. Now this is where, when you are looking for your future, kindly see where do I get it, where the industry will take me to manufacture. Now civil administrators and the state police organizations must reach out to the common man with sincerity and dedication and a sense of purpose. I'm sorry to say that India today is currently a poorly governed and a lawless nation. Sorry, so it is. So all those of you who join the police ever or join the IAS or public service commissions, kindly reach out and do your job, because we are all getting good salaries. Now, very important point, the next one as far as you are concerned, India must be made into a knowledge hub for its people, and not only for its people, for underdeveloped nations all over the world. We must be made a knowledge hub. We must identify our core competencies. We have a large number of core competencies with us. You are also now working to learn those core competencies in this temple of learning. So learn them well and work. We have to work towards imparting skills and knowledge to our students. So we have to become, as I said, a knowledge economy. And because only your knowledge economy will transform socially and economically the lives of our people. Now, as a leading IT power, the world acknowledges us as a leading IT power. We need to impart IT skills not only in software. We are, you know, leaders in the world in software, but that's not good enough. We have to be leaders in hardware, in manufacturing IT and things like that, in a more concerted and a cohesive manner. Our talent remains quite yet untapped. Now, the next point I have is that the fruits of economic growth must reach out to all sections and corners of India. More than one-third of India, unfortunately, and it's a matter of shame, 7 years after independence, is still below the poverty line. Now, you look at the economic disparity in India. You know, we have a very large number of billionaires and millionaires, and our middle class is growing, as it must grow. Excellent. But look at the disparity. We have millionaires, we have buying cars, not costing in lakhs, but costing in crores. And you go, and the poor don't even have an ambulance to reach the hospital. Isn't it a shame? You go to a five-star hotel in Delhi in the evening, and you will find just 3-4 people, not a bar, 3-4 people having a dinner, enjoying the best of food and whiskey, and the bill is over a lakh. And they pay it in a very nonchalant manner. It's so simple. And here we have so many lakhs and lakhs of people who don't even get one glass of clean water to drink. So we have to resolve this problem before we become a superpower. And kindly remember, that inequality and disparity can lead to social upheavals. So let's work hard. Let's be honest. We are all getting good salaries, and I'm sure you will also. Be honest and never take the law in your own hand, all you young people here. If you want this country to grow, and we can't grow individually, we have to grow collectively. Now, your public distribution systems, your basic medicine, educational, water, electricity, they must reach, as I said, they must reach the poorest of the poor. Also, please remember that all Indians are equal, irrespective of their religion, their region, their caste, their color or creed. And no one has the right to tamper with anyone's constitutional or basic rights. I'm sorry it is happening, and I have no shame in saying so. It's happening in some places. It must not happen. It must not happen. And finally, one more point, that the only idea of India, when somebody says, please explain what is the idea of India. The idea of India is democracy, secularism, and opportunities equally for all. And finally, as an old soldier, let me leave you all with a thought. I have had the privilege to wear the country's uniform with great pride and a childlike joy for 41 years, and that's why I can share this with you, that India is our motherland, and India is greater than all the heavens, remember that. India is greater than all the heavens. Let's work together to make it a great place to be born, live and die in. And I hope you will promise me, all you here, even those young boys who are talking, that you will all work to make India a great place to be born in, live in and die in. Say yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Now finally, I'd like to just leave you what a British historian once said about us. Now I'd like one of you, please get out of the corner. One of you. चलिए उठिए पढ़िए क्या लिखा है कम ऑन वन ऑफ यू प्लीज रीड दिस कम ऑन सरदार जी सरदार जी बोल प्लीज गुड द ओनली वे फॉर सेलिब्रेशन फॉर मैनकाइंड इज द इंडियन वे नाउ रिमेंबर दैट ओके रिमेंबरिंग पाकिस्तान एंड एज यू नो वी डिसमेंबर्ड पाकिस्तान एंड ईस्ट पाकिस्तान बिकेम बांग्लादेश दैट टाइम द प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ द यूएसए I don't know who this silly pilot was. The president of the USA was President Nixon. He threatened, and not only he threatened, they sent the 7th Fleet into a little off the Bay of Bengal. And you had a very formidable prime minister known as Indira Gandhi. She said, let them land here, we'll teach them a lesson. So no, I'm sorry, we are not the strongest armed forces in the world. I'm not saying that. We may be the best without being the strongest. But the fact is, nobody can defeat us, you know, as far as regular operations are concerned. So I hope that answers.
An incident is coming to my mind that you shared with me personally, Manikshaw Sahab, when he called his mustache, Mrs. Gandhi, Bangladesh. Since you mentioned Bangladesh, it might, get them interested.
You know, all this Bangladesh operations, Mrs. Gandhi had sent a large number of political leaders from all parties.
Before the Bangladesh operations, took place, as I said, to build up international opinion, build up public opinion all over the world, Mrs. Gandhi made 7-8 delegations consisting of leaders of all political parties, all across the political spectrum. He said Jai Prakash Narayan, you heard of him, who ultimately, fought against her in 77 and all that. Atal Bihari Vajpayee, things like that. And these delegations went to some of the main capitals in the world to tell them, look, we cannot take on the pressure of the East Pakistani refugees. They're coming, they're millions and millions coming. Our economy cannot take it. So kindly tell your protege action against the Pakistan army in East Pakistan and also in the West. I was incidentally in the West side as a squadron commander, a young major in the BDS service corps, in the Shakkargarh sector. Have you heard of Shakkargarh? No, okay, it is somewhere between Gurdaspur and Samar. It was a Saturday, and they came to this American High Park delegation, led by Henry Kissinger, which whom we were talking about. So they came on a Saturday, and they wanted an appointment.